You're able to see the screen, right?
Yes.
Okay, so in the previous classes, we discussed two routing protocols. One is RIP, Routing Information Protocol, and the other one is Open Shortest Path First, OSPF. So if you remember, these two protocols are basically used in unicast communication. Okay, or to be specific, these are the routing protocols which are to be used within a particular domain or within one autonomous system. Okay, my audio is clear or any disturbance you have?
It's clear, sir.
Okay, I'll have a headset. So when I consider this one path vector routing, this is a kind of variation with respect to what are the protocols we have seen before. This path vector routing is basically utilized for communicating or routing the packets between two different domains, or I can say two different autonomous systems. So distance vector routing and link state routing, both are interior routing protocols, and this path vector routing is exterior protocol. Okay, like that also we can say. So what is the problem we have with the distance vector routing? The problem is instability. Like after some hops, like if you cross after 16 number of hops, then you are going to have instability with distance vector routing. And what is the problem we have with link state routing? With respect to link state routing, we have the problem like you need to have information of entire network, and again you will have to have lot of memory space to keep the information of these networks. Okay, if I consider like a very big network is available, and each and every node has to have the information of that big topology with each and every router. So with respect to memory, you are going to have a lot of problem in link state routing, and also you are going to have the problem of flooding. Okay, so flooding creates lot of traffic which is not suitable. So these are the problems we have when I consider path link state routing and the other one distance vector routing, because of which these two routing protocols are not suitable when we go for a bigger network which consists of different autonomous systems. Okay, so that's the reason PVR has been introduced. So the difference between distance vector routing and path vector routing can be compared with a simple example of national map and international map. Again, if you remember your school days, you used to have national map and world map, and you used to locate different things on that particular map, right? So even in your national map, if you consider, you are going to have details like within a particular country how you can reach from one city to other city by using some roadways. Okay, even it includes small towns also. But the same thing, if I consider international map, you are not going to have all cities over there. Only basic cities which are connected maybe with some air traffic, they will be shown when I consider international map. So in a national map, you are going to have the details of each and every city. But in international map, most probably you will be going to have only country details. That is the difference when I consider national map and international map. Same way, when I consider distance vector routing, it is going to talk about within the autonomous system, within a particular area, how routing has to be done, what are the details, what are the network topology I have, that one your distance vector routing talks about. But when I consider path vector routing, we are going to talk about entire, maybe I can consider a big area, maybe in the form of metropolitan area network, or maybe for entire India a network which has smaller autonomous systems within that one. Okay, like that we can consider a bigger area in which I need to consider path vector routing. Okay, is it clear so far?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Then we will see other things like how these things are initialized, shared and updated when I consider path vector routing. So you see here, this is how initialization process happens in path vector routing. As you can see here, each and every autonomous system, we are going to have a dedicated router which communicates with other autonomous systems. And if you remember the previous concept, we said like there will be a router which will be which will have summary of entire autonomous system, and that summary it can exchange with other autonomous systems. So that's what we considered in the previous class, right? So here A1, C1, B1, D1, these are the routers which we can consider autonomous system routers, like the routers which carry the information of entire autonomous system to other autonomous systems. So when I consider these autonomous system routers, they are going to have the routing tables for their own autonomous system. So for example, you see here, let me point. So you see here, this is the routing table which is there at the router A1. So it says like it has a path to A1, A2, A3, A4, A5. These are some of the destinations which are there in AS1, Autonomous System 1. And the path it says is AS1 because they are available within autonomous system itself. That is the reason we are considering path as AS1. Similarly, I have C1, D1, D1. Okay. So like that, you are going to have the information of initial stage of this path vector routing. Then after achieving stability, you are going to have routing tables like this. So you see here, if I consider something which is there in autonomous system 1, so as it is shown here in table A1, you are going to have like this. All the destinations, that information will be there, A1 and so on till A5, and the corresponding path I have to choose is AS1. Let me go back and see where B1 is available. So if I have to go to B4 or B2 or B1 or B3, anything, I need to contact from A1 to B1, that is AS1 to AS2. So that is what written here. If I have to communicate with any of B1 to B4, the path is AS1 to AS2. Similarly, for C, we have AS1 to AS3. For D, I have AS1, AS2, AS4. So let me see how I can go to D. So it says the best path is AS1 and all the way to AS2, and from that you can go to AS4. Let me check it again. D1 it says AS1, AS2, AS4, but you cannot directly go over there because I do not have a direct connectivity from AS2 to AS4. Okay, it has to be like AS1 to AS3 and AS3 to AS4. So that variation you observe here, AS1 to AS3 and AS3 to AS4. That is how it has to go. Okay, because if I see B1 table, what it says, if it has to go to D1 to D4, it says it has to go from AS2 to AS3. AS3 to AS4. In that case, this whatever the entry it has given, it should be AS1 to AS3 to AS4. Okay, is it clear how you are getting this stabilized routing tables?
Yes, yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay. So loop prevention. What is this? When we consider distance vector routing, we said like there are some chances like loops may happen because like if you are getting information from someone without keeping the next hop information, there are chances like looping may happen. Okay, to prevent loops, what is done over here is you are going to see if your autonomous system path is available in that one or not. Okay, so router checks the received packet to see if its autonomous system is in the path list to destination. So you see here, for example, just a minute, let me erase all these things. Okay, so just consider you have exchanged some information, and A information has been exchanged with B, B information has been exchanged with C, C has exchanged with A. So if I have to go to D, okay, if I have to go to D, B says this is the path which you have to go, B, C, D. In case A says like, if I have to go to D, the path is A, B, C, D, like that if it says, okay. After some time, C has exchanged that information with A, and A has exchanged with B, okay. Then you are going to have like 2, 3, 4. That is the path which B has. But after some time, it should not be like 2, 3, 1, 2, 4. It won't happen because whenever it sees some information like to go to D, A has B, will check into this one and it will see like 2 is coming twice, or my autonomous system path is already available here, so I should not forward this particular packet, but I should be discarding this particular packet. Like that it will check and it won't allow loops to form. Okay, if it is available within the path list, then looping is involved and packet will be ignored. If it is not available, then only the packet will be received or processed. Policy routing. When a router receives a message, it checks the path if any router is against its policy. So each and since we are considering multiple autonomous systems available here, each and every router may have its own policy. Okay. In such case, whenever you receive any packet, you are going to see what is the policy which has been followed. If there is any policy, routing policy, which is against your own policies, in such case, you are not going to consider that particular path and you won't forward that particular path to your neighbors also. Okay, so that is policy routing. Then optimum path. How are you coming up with optimum path when you consider path vector routing? So what is the best suitable path when you are using PVR is the path which runs through less number of autonomous systems. Okay, that is the best path we can say. We cannot include metric here because of many autonomous systems. Okay, so why you cannot include metric here? Because when I consider different autonomous systems are there, each autonomous system may have its own metric. For example, autonomous system 1, I might be using RIP protocol. Autonomous system 2, I might be using OSPF. Autonomous system 3, I might be using again RIP. In such case, I cannot have one metric used for all the autonomous systems. So that is the reason we are not including metric in path vector routing. The path which has less number of autonomous systems can be chosen as optimum path, as discussed in the first part. But it is not always the case. There may be some exclusions, like you may be considering different criteria, like with respect to security, with respect to safety, with respect to reliability. If you consider any of these criteria, then there are chances like your path may have more number of you may be choosing an optimum path which has more number of autonomous systems also. Okay, then that is about path vector routing. We have seen how they are initialized, how they are flooded, okay, what are the rules we are following, what is policy routing, okay, and how you will be updating. These are some of the details which we have seen. Now we will see another protocol, BGP. BGP stands for Border Gateway Protocol, and this is inter-domain routing protocol. Like when we compare with RIP and OSPF, they are intra-domain routing protocols. This BGP is inter-domain routing protocol, which is based on path vector routing. It came into existence somewhere in 1989, and at present, fourth version of BGP is running. So we are going to discuss these topics under BGP. So first, when it comes to type of autonomous systems, the first type is stub autonomous system or stub AS. So what is this stub AS is? You are going to have only one connection to another autonomous system. Okay, only a source or sink for the data traffic. So that means to the rest of the world, if you consider, I have only one connection. Okay, that is also to only one another autonomous system. Okay, so it's something like I have an autonomous system here, I have another one over here, I have another one over here, and I have another one over here. They are interconnected. Let me consider this, this, and this. Again, we have a connectivity like this. So when I consider this particular autonomous system, okay, let me give numbering. One autonomous system, one has only one outgoing connection or one incoming connection to connect with other autonomous systems. Okay, so this kind of autonomous system is called stub autonomous system. Next we have multi-homed autonomous system. So the middle one which I have drawn here, the second one, okay, that has connectivity with almost three autonomous systems. So it has three links which are connecting to other autonomous systems through which it can send data traffic. So we call this one as multi-homed autonomous system. Okay, but when I consider the communication from one and four, autonomous system two is in between. So this is called transit autonomous system. So when I consider transit autonomous system, it will be neither the source of the data nor it will be the destination of the data. So it will be just an intermediate autonomous system which is helping the path vector routing to have communication or to establish with routing protocols. Okay, is it clear the types of autonomous systems?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So the next one I have is internal and external BGP sessions. So if you see here, we have a diagram where we have a border or autonomous system border router, and it is given the numbering as A1, and it is connected to four other routers. Similarly, I have another router, another autonomous system AS2, and I have a colored line which is going from AS1 to AS2. Okay, so that is considered to be exterior one, like in between two autonomous systems communication. Within, I have represented with dashed lines. Okay, exterior, a dark line or a continuous line, we can say for that matter, which connects two autonomous systems, that is exterior BGP session we call it as. Internal to the autonomous system, we consider interior border gateway protocol session. Okay, we have several types of BGP messages. So the first one is open message, update message, keep alive, and the last one is notification message. These are the four different types of BGP messages we have. And we have several path attributes over here. So what do you understand with this one? Path attributes. So we have like for each path you are going to have some parameters. Okay, about that parameters we are saying here. We have well-known attributes, optional attributes. So well-known attributes are nothing but these attributes, they must be recognized by each and every router. Optional attributes, they must be recognized only by we cannot exactly say must, but it's just an option. Like if you want, you can consider that optional attribute, or if you are not interested in considering, you can leave it, no problem. Again, these well-known and optional attributes, again they are subdivided. Well-known attribute is again divided into two types: mandatory attribute, discretionary attribute. When I consider mandatory attribute, this is the one which must appear in each and every route description. But when I consider well-known discretionary attribute, this is the one that must not be recognized by each and every router. Okay. So well-known, we are saying like we are dividing into two: well-known mandatory, it must appear in each and every router route description, and discretionary is something like that will be there in the route description, but it is not necessary for each router to recognize those things. Again, when I consider optional, I have optional transitive attribute, optional non-transitive attribute. When I consider optional transitive attribute, this is the one that must be passed to the next router by the router that has not implemented this attribute. For example, if I consider a router X, it does not understand this optional attribute and it does not implement that particular thing. In that case, it has to pass it to the next router, but it should not omit that particular optional attributes. Optional non-transitive attributes, these are again like they can be discarded if a particular router has not implemented that particular option. Okay. So path attributes, total two types, they are again divided into two more types. That's what we are seeing in this slide. Then what are the path attributes? We said like these are some of the parameters, right? So the parameters are like origin, autonomous system path, and next hub. So origin, like whether the source of routing information is coming from RIP protocol or it is coming from OSPF, that is what we are saying in origin path attribute. When I consider AS path, this attribute is going to consider what are the autonomous systems through which the destination can be reached. As we have seen in the previous routing tables, to reach a particular destination, we said like autonomous system 1, autonomous system 2, autonomous system 3, like that a path was there, right? So you are going to have the list of autonomous system through which the destination can be reached in autonomous system path. Then I have something called as next hub. So which talks about the next router to which the data packet should be sent. Okay. So if you are sending any packet to the destination, immediately what is the next hub or the next router to which this packet has to be delivered? That is next hub path attribute. Next, I have network layer reachability information. So this is going to define the network that is actually advertised by this message. For example, if you are sending any message, okay, path vector message and BGP messages will be there, right? Whenever you are sending these messages, basically a particular network will be advertising these messages. So NLRI, it will be giving the information like who is the actual network which is advertising this particular message. So it is going to have length field and also what is the corresponding IP address prefix. Okay, these are the two things you will be having. And when we consider BGP version 4, it supports classless inter-domain routing, that is classless addressing. So BGP supports classless addressing and BGP uses the services of TCP on port number 179. So that is about BGP. To summarize BGP, what we have seen is we considered path vector routing. We looked into how to initialize those things, how to update those things, how you will be blending those things. Then we have seen things like BGP, how it is different from distance vector routing. Like whatever the differences you have for path vector routing, the same things you can also replicate for BGP. Okay. And we have seen what are the types of autonomous systems we have and what are the attributes we have in BGP. These are some of the things which we considered. So that is about unicast routing protocols. Next, we will see multicasting and multicast routing protocols. Okay. So under multicast and multicast routing protocols, first we will try to address what is unicasting, what is multicasting, and what is broadcasting. Okay. So when I consider unicasting, it's like you are going to have one source and one destination. And there will be unique relationship or one-to-one relationship between source and destination. And when I consider the source IP address and destination IP address, they will be unicast IP addresses. Okay. If you remember, we have separate IP addresses for unicasting, separate group of IP addresses for multicasting. Do you remember that?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So when I consider unicasting, whatever the addresses you are specifying in the packet, they are going to be unicast source and destination IP addresses. So in unicasting, the router forwards the received packet through only one of its interface. How I can say it forwards only through one of its interface? It is because you are going to establish a path from source to destination and the packet has to travel only that particular path. It won't be choosing any other path. Okay. So this is multicasting. So when I consider multicasting, it is something like you are going to have one source, but destinations may be many. Okay, it's something like now I am teaching, source is one, but the destinations are multiple. Like whatever the how many number of students we have, that many destinations we are going to have. That is nothing but I am going to have one to many relationship. Like one source is trying to communicate with multiple people. So here the source IP address will be unicast IP address, but the destination IP address will be a group address or a broadcast, multicast address. Okay. Can you understand this? Like source IP address is unicast IP address, but when I consider the destination IP address, it is a group address or multicast address. So that is the difference we have when I consider unicasting and multicasting. In multicasting, the router may forward the received packet through several of its interfaces. So as you can see in this diagram, whenever this particular router receives a particular packet, it is sending on two links, but it is not sending on this particular link because it has no node which is interested in receiving this group communication. So it is not forwarding in that link. Okay. Similarly, it is sent on this particular link. Again, this router, it forwards on all the remaining three links. Okay. Again, this one, it is sending on this link. Like that, they are forwarding. So we have a chance wherein A router may forward the received packet through several interfaces which it has. So when I consider broadcasting, source and destinations have one to all relationship. Okay, so it's something like I am just consider if I am in a class and if I am talking to the people who are sitting in that class. Okay, I am not saying entire college, but within that class I am able to communicate with all. But instead, if I write something on a paper, two or three papers, and give it to only two or three students, in that case I am communicating with only two or three people. Okay, when I am speaking in a class, all the students who are there in the class, they are able to listen to it. That means within that particular thing, if I consider my class as a complete network, I am talking to all, that is broadcasting. But if I write a paper and give it to only one, it is unicasting. If I give it to 10 people, that will be multicast. So internet does not support broadcasting because it will lead to chaos in the network, like a lot of traffic will increase and you're going to have congestions and bandwidth problems will be there, because of which broadcasting is not at all allowed in internet. Okay. Then we have two different varieties over here, multicasting and multiple unicasting. Multicasting and multiple unicasting. So multicasting is something like you are going to have source address as unicasting and destination address as group address or multicast address, right? So is that point clear?
Yes, sir.
Got an error over here, sharing system audio passed. I don't know if you are able to hear. I hope my audio is clear.
Okay. Yes, sir.
When I consider multiple unicasting, as you can see on these links, okay, you are going to have multiple packets. So in multicasting, you are going to create one packet from source, okay, and that will be delivered on all links. Okay, and whatever the router I have intermediate, that is going to generate duplicate packets. If I have three links on which I have to forward, I am going to generate those three packets. Okay, but in multiple unicasting, if I have 1,000 members to whom I want to send the information, the source itself is going to generate 1,000 packets. Okay, so here what happens, source is generating single packet, but here source is generating multiple packets. A particular link, if I consider, it is carrying only one packet in multicasting, but if I consider a particular link, it is going to carry multiple packets. Okay, and what is the problem, where you are going to have problem, in the first one or second one, where you are going to have?
Second one, sir.
So obviously you're going to have a problem in the second one, because if you consider like a source generating packets for 1,000 people, there will be lot of gap or time delay will be there between the generation time of first packet and the generation time of 1,000th packet. Okay, so that's a problem you're going to have, and also you're consuming lot of bandwidth over here. Like if you consider a particular link, instead of sending the one particular packet, you are trying to send multiple packets. That's the problem we have in multiple unicasting. So in multicasting, single packet from source is duplicated by each router, and destination address is same in all the packets. And one single copy of the packet travels between any two routers. That is what we have seen in the previous slide. Okay, this is what we have seen. But the same thing, if I consider multiple unicasting, source is generating several packets. Okay, and if source sends five packets, each will have different IP addresses. Okay, there will be individual unicast addresses you are going to use. But in the case of multicasting, you are going to use group address. There may be multiple copies between two routers. Like as we have seen, a particular link had several packets, right? It's something like when a person sends email to group of people, this is multiple unicast. You cannot keep a unique mail ID for all, right? Okay. So it will be like when you type something, that particular link will send individual mails to individual people. Like I'll be, I want to send a message to 5 people. I'll keep addresses of 5 people separately, right? I'm not considering one mail ID for all the 5 people. Okay, that can be considered as multiple unicast. The email software creates multiple replicas of the message, each with different destination address. But the same thing, if I consider grouping of mail IDs, in such case, you are going to have single message transmit. Okay, so that's the best example you can consider email as a multiple unicasting. So when we actually look into more details of multicasting, this is more efficient than multiple unicasting, like with respect to generation of more packets or with respect to utilization of bandwidth. Okay, and this multicast requires less bandwidth, as we have seen before, and multiple unicasting, some of the links must handle several copies. Okay, because after that link, if I have 5 nodes to which I have to deliver the packet, then that link has to carry 5 packets. Okay, if there are 1000 destinations, there will be a lot of delay between the first packet when I'm generating and the last packet when I'm generating. So I cannot expect to have that much delay. In multicasting, you are not going to have any type of delay. So when we actually emulate, like we try implementing this multicasting through multiple unicasting, the result which has which was noticed by people is not so efficient when we compare with multicast. We are going to have long delays, particularly when we have many and many, like thousands of users. Okay, so we are not going to choose multicasting. Sorry, we are not going to choose multiple unicast. So is it clear, the concept of multicasting and multiple unicasting?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So next, we shall look into what are the routing protocols we have when I consider multicast routing. So in unicast routing, each router in the domain has a table that defines shortest path to all the possible destinations. Okay, that's what we have seen in unicasting. When I consider multicasting, instead of having a path or a shortest path to individual nodes, you are going to have shortest path to individual groups. Okay, that's what we are going to consider in multicast routing. So this is an example of a shortest path that can be possible in unicast routing. So as you can see here, if I have to reach different networks from R1, what are the costs and what are the next hops, that information is given here. We are not having exact details of the cost, but what is the shortest path 3, that information is given here. So if I have to go to network 1 or network 5, I have a direct connectivity from R1. And if I consider network 2, 3, 4, I need to travel through an intermediate router R2. Similarly, if I have to reach to network 6, I can reach via R4. That's how a shortest path 3 will be implemented when I consider unicast routing. The same thing, if I consider with respect to multicast routing, you are not involving shortest path 3 for a particular host, but you are going to consider a group of people. Okay. So we have different types here, like one is source based tree approach and the other one is group shared tree approach. And if I consider source based tree approach, each router needs to have one shortest path tree for each group. That is what we are going to have a condition in source-based tree approach. So the source-based tree approach, you can see here, the same like the kind of same network whatever we considered earlier, if you remember, the same N3, N2, N4 like that we have, right? So the same way we are going to have networks here, but instead of having the network information here, we will say like, if I have to, if I consider this particular network, I am interested in having multicast information from group 1, multicast information from group 4, multicast information from group 5. Similarly, I am interested in having the information from multicast information G3, multicast information G2, multicast information G1. Like that, each and every network will have the details like what is the group to which I want to communicate, to which I want to receive information. So you see here, source-based tree approach, what we are doing. If I consider G1, what are the next hops I have? I have direct link, I have the intermediate router R2, I have the intermediate router R4. Okay. Similarly, if I consider G2, I have a direct link, like wherever I have that G2 information, that path we are going to consider here. Okay. So the tree will have the details of that routers which are interested in having the information from that particular group. That is how a source-based tree approach will work. Similarly, if I consider group shared tree approach, okay, instead of having connectivity in the form of routers as we have seen in source-based tree approach, you are going to have a core router, okay, which will have connectivity to all of the intermediate links. Okay, see here, like if I have to go to G1, it says I have a direct link which is available. I can communicate with R2, I can communicate with R3, I can communicate with R4. So it's something like this is the network I have, okay, to which if I connect, I can communicate with R2, I can communicate with R3. This is the network I have, if I connect to this, I can communicate with R1. And I have another network over here, if I connect to this, I can communicate with R4. Okay, that is how we have some information. So see here, if I specifically consider a destination G1, okay, wherever I have that G1, all those routers are included in the next hop path. Okay, is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, but in the previous case, if you see here, this G1 is having only information of R2, R4. Okay, it is not talking about R3. Okay, because R2 will take care of how to reach R3. That is what we are considering in this case. But here, we are not considering like that. We are including all the routers which are including, which are connected for the respective groups. In the group shared tree approach, only the core router which has the shortest path tree for each group is involved in multicast. Okay, so if I consider source based tree approach, each router needs to have one shortest path tree for each group. Okay, so you see here, if I consider R2, I will have a shortest path tree. If I consider R4, I will have a shortest path. If I consider R2, I will have shortest path. Like that, individual routers, they are going to have shortest path. Okay. When I am looking from this R1, okay, when I am looking from this R1 to go to G1, I have a direct connectivity. I have a path through R2. I have a path through R4. If I have to communicate to G5, I have a path to R2. I have a path to R4. That is what we are considering in source-based tree approach. Similarly, you are going to have another table for R2. But when I consider group shared tree approach, only one router, core router, will have communication with all the remaining groups. Okay, only this one will be handling the multicasting. So it's something like R1, R2, R4, R3, they will send information to core router, and core router, it will take care of delivering the packets to the respective groups. That is the difference we have. So there is a possibility, like you can get a question on differentiate between source based tree approach and group shaped tree approach. Okay. So we have variation with respect to whether we are talking about core based tree approach or group shaped tree approach, like that multicast routing protocols can be further divided. Okay. See here, source based tree approach, it is divided into MOSPF, that is multicast open shortest path first, and DVMRP, that is distance vector multicast routing protocol. Again, under group shared tree approach, I have core based tree approach, CBT, okay, and we have a special protocol PIM, okay, path independent multicasting, we call it as path independent multicasting, under which if I consider PIM dense mode, it comes as under source based tree approach. If I consider PIM sparse mode, SM, it comes under group shared tree approach. Okay. So multicast link state routing protocol, that is the first one we shall look into. In this section, like we are going to see what is multicast link state routing, and we will also see what is MOSPF. Multicast link state routing uses the source based tree approach like we have seen, and you are going to have group membership which will be available in link state advertisement packets. Okay, so we considered in the previous case when we discussed link state routing, like you are going to have link state packets, right? So when I consider MOSPF, you are going to have group membership LSE that is flooded throughout the autonomous system. The router calculates the shortest path trees on demand. Like whenever you are supposed to do some kind of multicast communication, then only you are going to construct shortest path tree. Okay. Before itself, you are not having any routing protocol in this case, because we don't know when this multicast communication will be in use, right? So depending on that, we are going to whenever there is a demand, you are going to create that particular packet, create that particular route. And this MOSPF is a data driven protocol. The first time an MOSPF router sees a datagram with a given source and group address, the router constructs Dijkstra shortest path. So whatever we have said here, like on demand, in the same way, like we can also say the same is kind of data driven. So if I get a particular packet to a router, in which if I have a multicast address or group address, then you are directing the router to come up with Dijkstra shortest path tree for that particular multicast communication. Okay, that is what happening in MOSPF. And the shortest path tree is made all at once instead of gradually. Like you are not doing a step by step process, but all at once you are going to do this shortest path tree calculation. That is pre-made, pre-pruned, ready to use. Okay. You are not going to have different steps. All at once you are going to come up with shortest path tree. That's it. We are not going much details about MOSPF. It's something like you are going to have group advertisement packets, okay, and they will be flooded in the entire autonomous system, and you are going to construct the shortest path using Dijkstra algorithm, and this will be kind of a data driven protocol. Whenever there is any demand, only at that time you are going to construct this particular thing. Next we have distance vector multicast routing protocol. So what is the problem we have is if I keep on creating broadcast packets, it creates loops in the system. Okay, we said like LSA, it's trying to broadcast all the packets within the autonomous system, right? So if I consider like that, it will lead to loops in the system. So we want to overcome that one. So let's see how this m distance vector multicast routing protocol overcomes that one. So first we will try to look into the concept of RPF, reverse path forwarding, we call it as. Okay, this reverse path forwarding eliminates the loop in the flooding process. Okay, we will see what is this reverse path forwarding. So you see here, like when I consider the source, it is sending a packet to R1, or you can consider like we have multiple routers to which I want to send this particular information. So that packet is coming from source, and this R1 is looking into the packet, and it will see if I have the I have another duplicate of this particular packet. If I do not have, I am going to forward that particular packet. But one more thing, what is this reverse path forwarding is, you are not forwarding on the same link on which you have received. Okay, so let me see if I have another diagram. Okay, so I have received this particular packet, I am forwarding that. I might have received the same packet on R4 also. R4 may send that particular packet on R1, and if R1 sends on this link and this link, then there will be a loop. Do you agree with that point?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
So if I consider like source is sending to R1 and also R4, and R1 sends to R4 and also to R2, similarly R4 sends to R1 and R5, in that case, whatever the source has shared, you are going to have duplicate packets with R1 and R4. If you are not considering the duplicates, or if you are just forwarding the packet coming from R4 at R1, again on the link between R1 and source, then source will be receiving the same copy which it has forwarded. But we do not want that kind of things to happen. So to prevent that loops, only one copy is forwarded, the other copies are dropped. Okay, so when I consider this reverse path forwarding, a particular router forwards only the copy that has traveled the shortest path from source to the router. Okay, so I am going to look here, like for example, if I consider I'll erase just a minute. If I consider a packet coming from source to R1, whether this is the shortest path or this is the shortest path, that information R1 will look. Okay, and by looking at that information, you are going to forward. So if the packet has traveled shortest path, then I will forward the packet. Okay, if the packet has not traveled the shortest path, then I am not going to forward that particular packet. So the router extracts the source address of the multicast packet and consults its unicast routing table. Okay, how you are going to find shortest path? It is, you will see what is the multicast, whatever the multicast packet you are receiving, you are going to look what is the source in that one, and in your unicast routing table you will see like, if this is the source, what is the distance I have. Okay, direct distance or through someone, if you are getting, what is the distance. So by looking at that one, you are going to find whether it has followed the shortest path or not. Okay, then if I consider like the packet has just come from the hop defined in the table. Okay, like I have checked into the routing table, and like whatever the path we have in the routing table, in the same path the packet has arrived. In that case, I can fix it like the packet has traveled the shortest path from source to the router, because the shortest path is whatever we have in the unicast distance vector routing protocol. Okay, if a packet leaves the router and comes back again, it has not traveled the shortest path, like that we will be considering. Okay, so let me show that one again with this thing. So let me consider a packet has arrived from source to R1 like this. So R1 will consider its unicast RIP protocol, routing information protocol, and checks if I have to reach source, how I will be reaching. So from the table it says like I have a direct connection. So if I have direct connection, if source is sending some packet, I have to receive directly. There should not be any intermediate router. Okay. So I am checking whether I got like that or not. Let me take another scenario where source has sent to R4 and R4 is sending the information to R1. So I am looking into that packet. I found like the multicast address, whatever I have source address that belongs to the source. Okay. If I have a packet to send to that source, I have a direct link, but I won't be sending that packet via this R4 to the source. In that case, whatever the next hop I have in the routing table, that is not same as the router from which I have received this packet. Okay, so I can make sure like the packet has not traveled shortest path. Then you are going to discard that particular packet. Okay, so that is what we are saying in reverse path forwarding. So whether the concept of reverse path forwarding is clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay, that's good. So the same explanation is given over here, like whatever I said, to prevent loops, we are forwarding only one copy, and how you are forwarding only one copy, you are going to see if the packet has traveled shortest path or not, okay? And you are going to extract and consult unicast routing table, and you will see if the path through which you have received the packet is same as the next hop to which you will communicate if you have to communicate with the source. Okay, all those things match, you are going to consider the packet and you are going to forward it. If a packet, if you are considering like it is coming again to you, okay, then the packet will not be traveling the shortest path. Next, I have this particular thing where I have some kind of problem with reverse path forward. Okay, so can anyone by looking at this diagram say what is the problem I have?
Sir, here only with network 3 it is different, sir, like the directions.
Apart from that,
at router one it is going in both the directions.
So the problem in this case is when R1 sends a packet, it goes through network 1, R2 and reaches to network 3. Similarly, there is also another chance, the other path which is taking the direction of R1 to network 2, network 2 to R3 and R3 to R4 will also reach network 3. Do you agree with that point?
Yes, sir.
So I am going to have the same packet which is coming in this direction, okay, and which is coming in this direction. So we said with reverse path forwarding, we are eliminating the problem of flooding. But when I consider reverse path forwarding, I have a problem, that is a particular network may receive two copies. Okay, that is possible, right? Okay. So that is a problem I have in this reverse path forward. So we are coming up with another variation which we call it as reverse path broadcasting. So reverse path broadcasting, what it does is it tries to give information like for this network, who will be the parent router. Why do I need the information of parent router? I will receive packet only from my parent router, and I don't want to receive from anybody else if there is any multicast packet. Okay, so in RPB, for each source, the router sends the packet only on those interfaces for which it is designated parent. If it is not designated parent, the particular router, it won't send any packet to that particular router. And this designated parent router can be the router with the shortest path to source. Okay, how you will say who is my designated parent router? If I am the source, if I am sending to different people, okay, who are my one hop neighbors? Who are my immediate neighbors? That means with whom I have direct connectivity or with whom I have shortest path to reach all the nodes. Only on that particular links, you are going to forward this particular packet. Okay? You are going to receive the packet only on that particular links. Okay. So see here. If I want to go from R1 to network 3, what is the shortest path I have?
Through R2.
I'll try saying like this. R1 to network 1, network 1 to R2 and to network 3. So if I construct a shortest path 3 from network 3 to R1, it will be network 3 to R2, R2 to network 1, network 1 to R1. That means for network 1, who is the designated parent?
Network 3.
How come network 1?
In the reverse case, sir, reverse case from network 3 to R1.
No, in this diagram, when I consider network 1, who is its designated parent?
R1.
For network 2, who is designated network designated router?
R1.
For R3, it will be network 2. For
yes.
R2, it will be network 1. For network 3, it is R2. For network 4, it is R3. For network for router R4, maybe it may be network 3 or it may be network 4. Anything that is fine. So, whenever R1 gets a packet, it checks to whom I am the designated router. Okay. To all those networks or routers, it is going to forward the packet. And whenever I consider network 3, or in that case, when I consider R2, network 3 is child. Or for network 3, R2 is the designated router. In such case, R2 has to forward a packet to network 3. But for network 3, R4 is not designated router because that is not following the shortest path. In such case, I don't want to receive from R4. By using this particular concept, you are trying to overcome the problem of reverse path forwarding. Okay, and the problem is multiple packets which are being received at a particular node. That problem we will be overcoming with this reverse path broadcast. Next, we have reverse path forwarding versus reverse path broadcasting. So if I am using just reverse path forwarding, as shown in the diagram A, network 3 is receiving from R1 and R2. But in the second figure, you can see like for network 3, the designated router is R2. So it is receiving only information from R2, not from R1. That's how you can eliminate the problem of multiple copies arriving at a particular network. Then RPB creates a shortest path broadcast tree from source to each destination. It guarantees that each destination receives one and only one copy of the packet. So far we have looked into flooding and we said what is the problem with flooding. Then we went on to see reverse path forwarding. What is the problem with that? Like like you may have looping, and how you are overcoming that looping also we have seen. Then reverse path broadcasting, where we talked about the shortest paths from source to destinations, all destinations. And we said like reverse path broadcasting, make sure like what is it does reverse path broadcasting? It makes sure like only one packet is received by destination. We are not having duplicate packets. Then I have something called as reverse path multicasting. Okay, so reverse path multicasting, what happens? The first case, two cases, two figures you are familiar with. Then the last one, like pruning, grafting. Okay, so what is pruning, what is grafting? Any idea? So here, in order to have more efficiency, for example, if you see the figure C, there we have three different networks, but network one is interested in communication, network two is interested in communication, sorry, network two is not interested, network three is not interested. That is shown with dashed lines. Okay, so when network two is not interested in communicating, but it was interested earlier in communicating, in such case you are going to send a prune message. Okay, we call it as pruning or pruned route. That means earlier network 2 was communicating or participating in group communication, but right now it is not allowing that one. Similarly, after some time again network 2 wanted to participate in the communication, so it will send another message which is called as grafted route or grafting. Okay, so to overcome the problem of getting multiple packets, we consider the concept of reverse path broadcasting. But here also, like, we don't know how much time we have to reserve that particular place, so we got the concept of pruning and grafting. Okay, so to increase the efficiency, the multicast packet must reach out only to the networks that have active members. It's not like I'll keep on sending on all links, okay, but it will be like only on the links where we have active members. RPM adapts the procedures of pruning and grafting. Okay, so pruning we have seen what does it mean, and grafting we have seen what does it mean. The designated parent router of each network is responsible for holding the membership information. Okay, so we said IGMP earlier, right? IGMP is used for this kind of service. Okay, pruning messages. And then, like, I have grafting, where, like, earlier I came out of the network, but now I am want to join again, then grafting can be used. So by using these things, we are trying to increase the efficiency of the system by restricting the data to flow on only on those links where someone is interested in communicating. Okay, so that's grafting and pruning. Is it clear, grafting and pruning?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So RPM basically adds pruning and grafting to reverse path broadcasting, so that we are going to deliver only to the members who said, like, we will be communicating. We are not sending to each and every one. Okay. So I think we are done with group, like a source based tree approaches. Anyway, we will stop here.